June 22, 1990. The small town of Rose Isle, Manitoba, located about 100 kilometers southwest of Winnipeg, would gamble on an ambitious music festival, becoming a financial success for the small community before the end of the first day. Then 19-year-old Kyle Unger would attend the first and last Woodstick Music Festival weekend, which took place at the local ski resort just outside of town, Birch Ski Area. Also in attendance was 16-year-old Bridget Grenier, resident of nearby Manitoba town, Miami, and former classmate of Unger's, as well as 17-year-old Timothy Houlihan. Later that night, between midnight and 1:30 a.m., Bridget would be observed dancing, kissing, and fondling with Timothy Houlihan. Not long after, they would leave the main festival area, moving to a secluded, wooded part of the resort nearby. Timothy would not be seen again until 4 to 4:30 a.m. Around this same time, Kyle would return from the washroom, tell his friend John Beckett he had seen Bridget, quote, going at it with some guy, unquote. The pair would part ways between 2 and 2:30 after Kyle declared to his friend that he was seeking female accompaniment. When Timothy was next seen, his face and clothes were covered in mud, and he had scratches on his face with blood on his chin. Mr. Houlihan claimed that he was attacked in the forest by an unknown male, passing out afterwards as an explanation for his long absence. Despite allegedly being beaten to the point of unconsciousness, this would not deter Mr. Houlihan from continuing to party with his friends until the early morning. Before leaving, him and a friend had stopped to set fire to contents of a barrel near the entrance. Later that day, Bridget Grenier's naked body would be found lying in a nearby creek that ran through the resort's wooded area. She had suffered through a grisly beating, which included being bitten and strangled, struck several times in the head, mutilated, and brutally sexually assaulted. Police said this was one of the most horrifying slayings in Manitoba history. The small town of Rose Isle would be understandably devastated, and the pressure was now on for the police to solve the crime. The police investigation would commence immediately, and with a total of only about 400 guests in attendance the day of the festival, it did not take long for them to find witnesses and eventually suspects. On June 29th, 1990, police arrested Kyle Unger and Timothy Houlihan. Both were being charged with first-degree murder. Forensic evidence at the scene was both consistent with the blood Timothy had on his shoes, as well as both his head and pubic hair samples being consistent with the hair samples recovered from the victim's clothes. Also recovered was a single hair that was deemed consistent with Kyle's sample, despite methods back then relying on now very obsolete technology. On June 27th, Timothy Houlihan would admit to having consensual sex with Bridget, but claimed soon after he was attacked by an unidentified male who left him unconscious. He was then asked if he had seen Kyle that night, to which he replied no. He would then give two very different descriptions of both Kyle and his attacker. This discrepancy, however, would be ignored by the police, who have now implicated Kyle. The police were now convinced relatively early on that it was likely two young males that were responsible, with Kyle being Houlihan's attacker. In this case, as well as many alike, a contributing factor would be tunnel vision, where police become willfully blind despite contradictory evidence. This, of course, would be compounded by the outrage amongst the community and pressure on police to convict. Mr. Houlihan's second statement would directly implicate Kyle in the murder, giving the police a description of the murder that was consistent with what evidence they had gathered at the scene. He claimed that while Kyle did the majority of the work, Mr. Houlihan did punch her a couple times at Kyle's request and helped move the body, doing both out of fear for his own safety. Houlihan's statement would not only bolster the police's adherence to their own version of the events, but also shifted the majority of the blame to Kyle. In December of 1990, the charges against Mr. Unger would be dropped after a preliminary hearing due to lack of evidence. While this could have been the end of Kyle's legal woes, the RCMP was unrelenting in their attempts to convict Kyle. Their first big attempt would employ the use of a jailhouse informant. The most common form of informant testimony comes from a jailhouse informant, usually offered incentives like reduction of sentence, withdrawal of criminal charges, and even money. In many past wrongful conviction cases, these deals are often kept secret from official court procedure, The Innocence Project reports that more than 15% of wrongful convictions overturned by DNA testing included an informant testimony against the defendant. The RCMP interviewed upwards of 20 inmates, found only 5 willing to testify, and could only call on one reliable enough for the court. Jeffrey Cohen, the jailhouse informant selected to testify, claimed to have shared a cell with Kyle during pre-trial custody. He would then tell the courts that Kyle told him, quote, "I killed her and I got away with it," unquote, right before being released following this day of proceedings. This would be proven impossible, however, as Kyle was released from the courthouse directly, not from the remand center. Cohen would later admit that he had lied on the stand, further stamping out any chance of a conviction via this avenue.
Rats or fakes or whatever you want to call them are exceptionally unreliable. I guarantee you I can bring you people who will say you've murdered somebody and you confess to them. If you want to buy it and pay for it, you'll get it. You can empty the jails if you want. I mean, who wouldn't?
It was clear to the RCMP that they would be unable to get a conviction through proper gathering of evidence and ethical police work. Instead, they opted to use the, at the time, newly developed Mr. Big Sting method. A practice banned in countries like Britain and the United States, this often expensive method involves employing a group of undercover officers that will vary in size depending on the case. This group fabricates a fake type of criminal organization, where members will attempt to steer the target towards the group's leader, i.e. Mr. Big, so that they may draw out a confession, which can be then used as evidence in trial. While expensive, this technique is often reserved for serious crimes like murder, and of the 350 times it's been used, the RCMP reports a 95% conviction rate. Kyle's Mr. Big experience had 2 of the 4 officers involved stage a car breakdown just outside where Kyle lived. The primary undercover officer befriended Kyle and offered an opportunity to become involved in a criminal organization. He would soon be sent to interview with Mr. Big, wanting to make a good impression on the boss and not embarrass his new friend. On June 22, 1991, Corporal Forbes, Mr. Big, would tell Kyle that his friend mentioned he had whacked somebody, and he would infer that he would be more inclined to trust Kyle if that were the case. Kyle would eventually falsely confess to the murder, offering additional information over the following days, but also made many contradictions regarding the details of the murder. These inconsistencies were expectedly ignored by the police, yet another example of how focused on Kyle the RCMP's tunnel vision was. Kyle would later maintain that he lied about murdering someone because he thought it would impress.
Well, you take a man who was down and out, destitute, homeless, jobless, and you offer him more money beyond his dreams, and you can make that man say anything you want him to say.
For Kyle, the allure of wealth, power, and friendship far surpassed any concerns he had lying about a murder to a supposed crime boss for street cred. In this case, as well as the majority of false confessions, the option to falsely confess was preferable in some way to the inverse. While Kyle was drawn in with positive consequences, others can be threatened with negative consequences, or being beaten by the negative consequences into submission. It is then no surprise the Innocence Project reports that 25% of DNA exonerations have had innocent defendants who had incriminated themselves in some way, delivered completely false confessions, or pled guilty. The prevalence of blatantly ignoring inconvenient truths amongst these cases points to an underlying theme of professional misconduct or outright indicating to be a significant contributor to wrongful convictions. Kyle would be rearrested on June 25, 1991, being convicted of first-degree murder alongside Mr. Houlihan on February 28, 1992. Both would appeal shortly after, but only Houlihan's appeal would be successful, granting him a retrial at a future date. Timothy Houlihan, then age 21, would choose instead to take his own life while out on bail. At the beginning of the investigation, RCMP spokesman Constable Sangster told the Winnipeg Free Press, quote, "The suspects were identified early on in the investigation, and a combination of evidence from witnesses and forensic evidence have gotten us to this point. unquote. An article published a year and a half later would further reveal local residents were quick to refer to Unger as an outsider, commenting on his temper and difficulties he faced while in school. Chief Investigator Corporal Kathy King would comment on the ongoing investigation, as well as the interviews that had been recorded up to that point. She would tell the Free Press that Unger should not be underestimated. Quote, "He's by no means a stupid person. I believe what he told the undercover officers was the truth." Later on, she described her initial interview with Houlihan, saying he was very nervous and had injuries, but they sent him home because he was a young offender at the time. Later on, she would comment that the RCMP concluded they could not totally eliminate Kyle Unger, which is why they undertook the undercover investigation, as they felt there was no other way to find out the truth. This conclusion came as a result of an independent review of the handling of the case launched by the RCMP. Corporal King would clarify, saying, and I quote, "It was done to see if we overlooked anything. Who's to say we hadn't missed anything?" The head prosecutor for Kyle Unger's case was none other than the now infamous George Dangerfield, who was known in the 1980s as Manitoba's Star Crown Prosecutor. Dangerfield, who was well-liked by his colleagues at the time, has since seen four of his high-profile murder convictions quashed.
He was just a rough, shrewd prosecutor. And he was out for victory at any cost.
And Hirsch Walsh believes Dangerfield's trust of the police was compounded by his admiration of the British legal system.
And he fancied himself as a barrister. And barristers get the brief handed to them, but it's really a solicitor who checks it all out first. Here there was nobody checking it out or standing as a buffer or looking at it and saying, wait a minute, it doesn't make sense. Or what about this? Or where is the exculpatory evidence? I want to see it. What is it? I think that was really where the problem lay.
Among these three other cases, James Driscoll's would be the first to come to light. Originally being convicted in 1991, evidence from a hair microscopy would originally place James Driscoll at the scene of a murder. James, however, was released from prison in November of 2003 after a new DNA testing technology became available, rendering hair microscopy very obsolete. This revelation would lead to the creation of Manitoba's Forensic Evidence Review Committee in 2004, which would begin to review other cases that used hair microscopy results as evidence. Soon after, the single hair originally found on Bridget Grenier's body was revealed to not have belonged to Kyle. In addition to this, a forensic orthodontologist found that the bite marks were also not made by Unger. With the pool of incriminating evidence now composed solely of Kyle's Mr. Big confession, the prosecution would be unable to create a convincing narrative. Kyle was granted bail on November 5th, 2005, after a judge expressed serious concerns that a wrongful conviction took place. After spending 14 years in prison, Kyle Unger would once again experience life outside of a cell. Nearly 4 years later, on October 23rd, 2009, now 38-year-old Kyle Unger's name would finally be cleared when Manitoba's Deputy Attorney General formally withdrew Kyle's charges, requesting he'd be officially acquitted. Despite a retrial being ordered back in March of that year, the prosecution would call no evidence.
What is this moment like for you right now?
First day of the rest of my life, a new beginning.
Careful, someone grab one.
Though Kyle was officially acquitted of a conviction for a crime he hadn't committed, Kyle's battle for justice was not over yet. While the Manitoba Crown did withdraw Kyle's charges, they would refuse to offer any kind of financial compensation for the 14 years he had served. The Attorney General's office, as well as the RCMP, had refused to take any responsibility for the wrongful conviction, citing that the damages he suffered were, quote, caused or significantly contributed to by his own conduct, which includes, but is not limited to, his repeated admissions of having committed the offense for which he was convicted. These officials are essentially downplaying their use of the coercive tactics they used on Kyle to draw out a false confession. On September 21st, 2011, Kyle Unger would file a $14.5 million civil lawsuit against both the RCMP officers and the prosecutors involved in his case. 8.5 years later, and a court date has still yet to be decided. People like Kyle, who've served sentences for wrongful convictions, aren't given access to the resources guilty prisoners can receive when released on parole. Exonerees are released to the public with no type of guidance, accommodations, or employment opportunities, as these measures are usually put in place to prevent recidivism amongst those who actually committed the crime they were convicted for. Reintegration, being left up to the exoneree, proves to be very challenging, especially for someone like Kyle, who not only spent 14 years in prison, but was robbed of his most crucial years when it comes to things like career development, starting a family, and enjoying the remainder of his youth. Kyle Unger had also been forced to live with the negative public opinion and suspicion, which was even more pervasive in the years prior to his official acquittal. Kyle has been unable to return to his small town where he had once lived, as many residents have been unable to renounce their initial beliefs.
As for Kyle Unger, he's at home in Merritt, British Columbia, doing what he did when he was imprisoned at 19, tinkering with old cars, trying not to think about the 14 years he lost.
I just want my life back, and I want to get on with it. And you can't do that by sitting around hating everybody and moping and feeling sorry for yourself.
Even with everything that Kyle has been through, he remains dedicated to keeping his life on track and optimistic that he will one day receive the compensation that he deserves.